You're tuned in to Ask the Master Auto Technician. Car questions? Get answers right now. Call 850-763-0555.
James Auto Center, we fix it right, guarantee. Beep, 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 yeah.
All right, welcome back to Ask the Master Auto Technician. I know Rob Lapham is going to be calling in a few minutes, but I got Thomas with the 2001 Audi Turbo, I believe. Tell me a little bit about your Audi. Thomas, what's the problem with it?
Hey, James. Good morning.
Good morning.
Listen, I tell you what I've done. I've got an Audi.
Audi.
Yeah. But anyway, it's a 2001. It's a TT Quattrum, but none of that I don't think matters.
All right.
But what happened is the key got busted on it. Mm-mm. And now, I tell you what, it's been glued back together and glued back together. And I'm wondering if this is the key problem. But whenever you start it, a lot of times the tack won't move, the gas pan won't move. It's like it's switched off, but yet it'll still start and run.
Here's what I'm going to recommend. I would recommend go see a locksmith, have them recut. That's a laser key you have on there, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, and I've got to go, though, all the way to Mobile.
Well, you might want to try the local locksmiths here. A lot of them are doing...
I did. I called just about everybody that I could think of in town.
Oh. You
know, even the Volkswagen people, I thought for sure.
Yeah, they can't laser cut one. Dadgum, I kept thinking
they say
Panhandle
it's got a rolling code or something. But do you think that would cause all those problems?
Normally, no. If the car will start and it does run, and even though the key is still up there in that position, I mean, it's still in the same position, even though you got
The key is cut, you know, like a regular key.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can just stick it in the ignition
and
start it. But, you know, then it's got, like, the door lock and everything in that key.
The fob.
You know?
So long as the fob is right in that area, the transmitter will be receiving it and should be working. But you say your only problem is with your tachometer not working. Is that what you say goes wrong?
Well, no. It's almost everything, you know, that's on the dash.
Right.
The tach, the gas hand. The heat thing still works. I guess it must be.
So the temperature gauge works. The temperature gauge works, but your tag doesn't work and a few other things don't work. It sounds to me, I have to do a little investigating. And so here's what give me a call tomorrow. I'll do a little investigating on those 2001 TT and see if there's a technical service bulletin for it. And I'll let you know tomorrow what you might be able to. There may be something very common that you may be able to do yourself here locally without having to go all the way to Tallahassee or Jacksonville.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
I don't know. I'll take a look and let you know, Thomas. Give me a call tomorrow morning.
Well, thanks a lot, Jack.
You're very, very welcome. Thanks for calling. I appreciate that. I want to get Rob Lapham here calling all the way from Port St. Joe. He's running for U.S. Congress, District 2. How are we doing this morning, Rob?
We're doing just great, James. And if you're checking out on that Audi problem, don't forget that once upon a time, we used to be able to walk around to the front of the car, the bumper there, and put the hand crank in and turn it.
Well... that was before my time.
Putting thumbs down on that down the hall, so she thinks I'm full of it.
That was a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. And I believe it or not, I've never had to work on one of those, but I do know the principle behind the can crank. But all the horror stories I heard from my grandfathers about those things kicking back and breaking people's arms and hands. Like, oh, man, I don't know why we ever had anything like that. But that's amazing how we can, you know, just the invention of the electric starter was a milestone in the automotive industry. And that seems to be something that we seem to be thinking about maybe reinventing Congress up there, because for so many years it seems like we keep sending the same people to Washington expecting different results, and well, nothing really happens. Our taxes go higher, we get less in return, and we keep fighting these unconstitutional, unwinnable wars and just keep getting farther and farther in debt. And I don't know, is there any change out there you can hope in the horizon?
Oh, well, I do think certainly the public becomes progressively more dissatisfied with Congress all the time. I mean, I'm pretty sure that the current polls show them rated even lower than lawyers and used car salesmen.
Oh,
not to dump on either of those
on lawyers, well, lawyers or used car salesmen, but still, they're not very popular right now. I mean, I think the Congress is about as popular as Venezuela's Congress, and they're rioting in the streets down there. What am I talking about? They're rioting in the streets here, come to think about it. But I'd like to see that change. How are we going to change that?
Well, for a start, we have got to stop electing Republicans and Democrats to Congress, and it's not going to happen overnight.
No.
But, as I said before, number one, and this is not the only thing, but number one, they continue to spend more money, have for more than eight decades, always spend more money than they take in. It's something we don't do in our own families. You've got to, if you run up a big credit card bill, you have to work to go ahead and pay it down. Pay it down.
That's true.
And what it comes down to, frankly, more than anything, is integrity. When you add up all of the campaign promises and then look at what the results are for either Republicans or Democrats, there is very little integrity in almost all cases. You can't trust them. If you can't trust somebody, it almost doesn't matter what position they are articulating, and they may speak to your, a candidate may speak to your favorite issue and adopt the very position that, that rings true to you that you want to see happen.
Mm-hmm.
But if you can't trust them, it doesn't matter what the heck they say. And I'm very disappointed with the integrity, with the horse trading that goes on. Congress people, of course, having to run every 2 years, they're always campaigning, mm-hmm. they're always after money. They always make promises they can't keep in order to get the money, in order to get reelected. It's a vicious circle.
It does seem to be true.
I don't know how to effectively articulate to the audiences that I speak to on the issue of integrity. All I know is I'm not going to make a single promise that I don't keep. If elected and serving in Washington, I am going to sponsor legislation to cut, eliminate, reduce, and I can go through a list of every single one of the more than just over a dozen different federal departments.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to cut spending in order to start to bring our budget under control.
Well, okay, let's take one department. I have a lot of people out there say, okay, you want to cut a department, but all these departments are, we've got to have, like the Department of Education, we've got to have that. And I said, well, we didn't have the Department of Education, we didn't have that until the Carter administration. I mean, I went all through high school, all through public school without a federal Department of Education, and I think I got a pretty good education compared to what we have now.
You don't need it, James. I mean, that's just one of that they're all. In fact, Department of Education is one of the easiest ones to shut down. It started about 36 years ago, right at the tail end. Actually, it was during the Reagan administration the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare Education split off to become its own department. So, 35 or so years old now. During that time, the federal Department of Education has spent $1.5 trillion. For its particular objectives, and the test scores, as I said, comparing U.S. students, K-12, reading, writing,
right.
math, continues to drop as compared to other countries around the world. I've seen statistics that show that we are as low as 36th in the world. I don't know that I believe it, but there's a report out published there. And once upon a time, decades ago, we were first.
Yeah, out of 100.
The Department of Education has done nothing. There's only one job they perform that frankly could be transferred to the military, and that is run the school districts overseas for our military personnel's dependents. We shouldn't have the military overseas in the first place, but given that they're there, and I would transfer that education coordination function to DOD and just wrap up the money that the Department of Education
So that what you would recommend, have a State Department of Ag. Of education, I guess, because every state does have a Department of Education, but we don't need to make it redundant by having a centralized government that sends down orders from the top. Here in Washington, we want you, the State Education Department, to tell your local districts this is how they're what they're going to teach. But that's what we got right now, if I'm not mistaken. I mean, we got the state and federal telling our teachers what to teach, what to test for, how to test, and yet our grades, and we spend more money per child than just about anyone out, any country out there, and yet our test scores even here in Bay County are flatlined or dropping, very insidiously dropping. I mean, we maintain a B average. We got some high schools out there in this town that have an incomplete rating. They didn't get A, B, C, D, E, or F. They got an incomplete, and I'm going, okay. And they're appealing that, they say, but the point being is, education, and they don't teach kids basic concepts anymore about life. They don't teach them how to balance a checkbook. They don't teach them how to fix a car. They don't teach them how to cook a cake. They teach them how to take a test. And then when they graduate from high school, I got people I can't hire and won't hire. I
hear you. And, of course, and you have mentioned yourself on prior programs, aside from all that, or in addition, you've got this economic nonsense whereby the regulatory burden the Fed's place on school districts across the country, they are, on average, spending 15 cents for every 11 cents of financial relief they get from the federal government. So it's a net drain on our local taxpayers in terms of keeping the schools going.
I did not know that.
It's a financial piece of nonsense. Of course, you have the Common Core nonsense on top of that. And it is detrimental to the education of our children, period.
We got a minute and a half here. I went too long on the first segment here. Common Core. I have a lot of people that jump up and down about Common Core, and they talk about how we don't need it and all that. But those same people that jump up and down say, oh, but we've got to do it. I've had teachers tell me, I hate Common Core, I dislike Common Core, but I've got to teach it, and it's the way it's going to be, and we can't change it. Is there anything people can do that this, because I don't think, maybe I'm wrong, maybe I'm not that smart, but the type math they're talking about where it takes 30 steps to add 12 plus 12, you know, I'm going, you mean I can't just add two and two and, you know, put out all that together? No, you have to break it down to 15 different steps, or not quite that many, but still, to and they say it's supposed to encourage people to think. And I'm going, I don't know how that makes people think. makes them think
James,
harder.
All the students have, and educators know this, they have different learning styles. I am sure the Common Core approach would work for some students, and maybe they actually prefer to go through that analytic. It'd drive me nuts, to be honest with you.
Me too.
But I believe that Common Core should be nothing more than just another study, a curriculum, if you will, that educators ought to be aware of and then decide. And again, it's in the context of the local school district and what the parents want.
Right.
But decide what elements of Common Core, if any, ought to be incorporated into the curriculum. It is absolute nonsense to have these D.C. bureaucrats mandating anything, and I will vote to defund it.
That's what we need to do. We need to defund a lot of things and bring the local control and education down to the local level, the local school boards, because I think they are more in touch with the students than people in Washington or Tallahassee.
You bet.
And I know we're running out of time here. So if people want to know more about Rob Lapham for Congress, they can go to robforcongress.org. And that's spell out the word for, robforcongress.org. And you can find your platform, you can find out, make a donation if you want to, because it costs a lot of money to run from Bay County all the way down to Ocala and back up to Tallahassee and Lake City. So that's a pretty big district you got. So if people want to help you out, they can go there, right?
You bet. James, thank you so much, and good luck with researching the Audi issue.
Yes, those Audis can be naughty. All right, we'll talk to you next Tuesday, Rob. We'll talk to you, everybody, tomorrow morning. It's Rotary Wednesday, so if you want to go to Rotary, give me a call tomorrow morning, and I'll treat you to breakfast. Hey, this is James Morris. Talk to you tomorrow morning. Bye-bye, everybody.
James Auto Center. We fix it right, guaranteed. Beep, 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 beep. Yeah.